Hey everyone, today we're going to talk about PowerShell and arrays, so how to store multiple things in one variable. Let's have a look. Hello again. If you haven't met, my name is Kamil Procesin and I've been recording that YouTube videos which are mostly about PowerShell, and we went through the whole course how to actually use PowerShell, and now I'm going more into, I pick certain topics that will help you to understand it better and hopefully get better in PowerShell at all. And today I picked arrays. And why arrays? Because either consciously or even unconsciously you've been using them to storing multiple pieces of data. An array is basically a data structure that allows you to collect multiple items under one collection so that these items can be accessed individually, iterated over, or even change if needed. So in other words, it really allows you to bundle multiple things together under one variable effectively. So how we get around the arrays? Create the array is pretty much, it's that bit, it's an at sign, and then we just have a brackets. So we see this one, what we'll do, we see this one, we create a blank array. So if you just see if there's anything in it, well, there's really nothing in it. So if I actually do that, it gives me things like, for example, count, yeah? So obviously I have nothing in array, so it says it's zero, but it's there. So let's, for example, now create another array that will have some pieces of information. Yeah, it's just three text strings for the starter. Done it, so let's see how does it look. So we can see they are each on the separate lines. That means there are three individual items in it. So let's see now what actually it says. And now we see that actually I got three items in my array. So that's what's expected, isn't it? Although we can, in PowerShell, we can actually use a little bit shorter version if we want to, and we can drop the parentheses and add signs, so we can actually just separate the items via comma. So let's try this. And again, we have the same one. Although whenever I've seen it, I've really seen this format. This is kind of very obvious that you are implementing array in here. It might be, well, it's not that obvious, it really, because you could have actually this, somebody could quickly look and this is like, looks like a long, one long string, but well, you can do that. Whether you will, it's up to you. So what we do, obviously we need sometimes access that things in the array, and they are zero based index. So what does it mean? It means that pretty much the first item in array we have a zero rather than first, isn't it? Then second is third, and etc. etc. So we must remember that. So if we now look at it, obviously first one is table, and this is correct. Third one is coffee, which is correct. Now this one, minus. So when you start counting from the minus, we're going actually from the last one. So we don't need to know how many items are there. We can just tell it, give me the last one. And this is correct. We can also in one go request multiple items. So as we can see, they are coming, or we could just use this shortened version, which gives me everything from zero to the two. So really from the first to the third one. Or we can even go opposite. So we can go downwards if you want to. Quite interesting stuff. So what will happen if, I don't know how many there are, maybe I'm expecting there's like, you know, I don't know, 20 items, 21, I want to accept it, access it. Let's see. Well, nothing happens. Fair enough, PowerShell doesn't throw errors, so it's something worth to pay attention on that. Oh, it didn't throw the error at me, so maybe it's okay. But, well, actually it's like a silent error, because if we actually do boolean, yeah, it can be that true or false, because there's nothing, it's empty, it says false. So PowerShell knows it's false, yet it doesn't throw error. So something to be, well, worth to be wary about. Okay, so what else we can do? Arrays really don't care what we put inside of them, so you can do something like that. So we see I have a string, a digit, actually some sort of commandlet output, which will be an object, and then another string. So if we now display it, we see that PowerShell happily print it out. I mean, obviously you can do that, but should you? I mean, it's really unusual when you mix things in array, but if you ever have to, then, well, you can just pretty much do it. Pretty much more often, we store objects, isn't it? When you go and, let's say, request stuff from API on the multiple computers, effectively you might be getting objects, not even realizing it. So for starter, we just go and create simple object that has a 3 items in it, objects, and then we have a name and have an email. So what we can do? We can go and just retrieve it. And as you can see, you've probably seen this also quite often, that we have a header and then values, header and values. Like normally we will have actually objects. So those are really 3 separate objects, and PowerShell just prints it out nicely for us. So if I try to grab the last one, that's here, that's Fiber, that's my cat's name. I call him Fiber because he's quick and you can't really see him. So yeah, Fiber Optics, that kind of makes sense for his name. But I can, for example, only access only now one property. So if I'm only after email, I can only retrieve emails. Or if I need to find a specific item in the property, for example, now I'm looking for somebody with the name John, I can just go with my array and it tell me return only where the object is. Object's name, which is this, equals John, equals this. So I should only get one, and there we go, we have only one. Or if you are prefer to do it in the method way, .source, which supposedly be faster than actually piping stuff, so that might be actually more useful when you have thousands of records to process, then we can do it that way, which is might be looking a bit odd if you are used to piping. So let's have a look for this. We have my object, obviously, then I'm .where. This is a method. And then in where we have obviously the normal parentheses, then curly brackets, and then it's just normal way of like you would in piping. So we have a PS item, the name of property, John. And what we do here, once it's retrieved, I'm really telling it, okay, just give me the email. So effectively you should get only that piece of information. And there we go. We got this one pretty much. That's how it should work. And something to be also, so obviously that will be a bit different to what we had before, but effectively we have a variable object I didn't create and I tried to access something, yeah? So when I try to access it, it froze because it's null. It doesn't exist really. So that might be a case when you are expecting something to happen that will populate your array, but effectively actually didn't do that. It didn't populate your array and it doesn't exist. Therefore, you will get that error. So maybe when you are especially writing scripts, worth to take care of that condition. In case it didn't get populated, then, you know, do start or do something else with the error. But that's what happens. So when you have an array, yeah, like we created before, and we just try to index to a value that doesn't exist, PowerShell was silent. But when we don't have a variable and we try to index it, then we get an error. So now how can we loop through this, yeah? How we can iterate over my array? And pretty much I prepared a few examples depending on how you like to do looping. So what we have? We have a bunch of domains of BBC, GitHub, YouTube and blah blah, just for fun. And this setting, I do progress preferences silent. Why? Because the command that I'm using, test connection, next connection, will always print out to the console. And we actually spam our display, and effectively, in here we wouldn't be able to really see the results. So that's why at the moment I'm suppressing the progress preference. So what we're doing? On the for each loop, for each domain from this list, I will pretty much dump everything to the result, and then I will testing testing that domain name, and I'll say quiet. And when you do testnet connection with quiet, it will only return true or false depending whether it was successful or not. If you don't do quiet, it actually gives you quite a lot of information, which for this case I don't want. And then I am just printing that result. So let's try this. And we can see BBC is pinging, GitHub is pinging, YouTube is pinging. And yeah, that will be probably another suppress for warnings, but pretty much that domain doesn't exist, so it doesn't print. But that's how I could iterate through that array. The other way, we can pipe to for each object, and pretty much the difference in that approach is that actually I'm using PS item. Yeah, I'm using that sign because now I'm in the pipe, therefore I don't have access to domain. I mean, you will be just seeing that the in the fuzzy stars PS item will be BBC, then there will be GitHub, etc. So that's really the main difference. And then we have for each method, which is supposed to be faster than this one, but I don't know. And that's pretty much the same way. We have PS item, okay? And the last one, because there's for loops, and I did video on for loops, Therefore, I can show you how we can iterate through for loop. And with for loop, it's obviously slightly different because we need to specify index, and then we iterate as for the number of items in the array. And then what we do, the difference is in that pane, I'm telling you, you go through domains, and then you give me first, second, third, etc. result, and then we print it out. So let's try. And yep, everything's happy. So that's pretty much how we can iterate through array. What else? We can also update values in the array. So when we look, so I specify the week, yeah, days of the week. And now I want the third one. So obviously the third one should be Wednesday, and it is. So let me now overwrite the Wednesday with bool. So I'm doing week, the value I want, and then equals the new value. So let's try this. Okay, week and also week two. Let me say it's bool. And it's also, when you actually retrieve the whole array, it's also bool. That's how it works. And what if we try to again, now index, I mean, update something outside of the index, it fails. So again, when we just try to access it, yeah, when I try to access stuff, it doesn't exist. PowerShell says nothing. Although when I'm telling you go and update that value that doesn't exist, it doesn't add it, and it also doesn't update it. There's nothing to update, so it froze. So it's also something to be interesting. You cannot just go and add something. And we get to the adding to arrays in a little bit, because this is a bit, it's a bit special. Okay, join. So we have few operators on the, when we have a array. So for example, now we have a night week, and I want to display them in one line. And that's, for example, how you can make a CSV file. So I'm telling you, you join it on the specific sign as, and we can see what happened. PowerShell pretty much converted this into one string. So then having this as the separate items, I just have now one long string I can pass on to, for example, other application. Or if I don't want actually put any sort of sign or delimiter between them, I can just do the null. So as we can see, there is nothing between them. We can do search like in the SQL with in. So if I look for the is there Tuesday in the week? Yes, there is. This is true. Or we can match a little bit of the text. So in that case, I'm looking for values in the array that have a value of yes. So let's see. Oh, wait, at the end, run. And we can see there is Tuesday, which is correct. Adding items to array. So problem with arrays is that array is by definition fixed in the memory size. Therefore, you shouldn't be able to change its content. You shouldn't be able to add new items to it. And PowerShell does a little bit of heavy lifting for you actually when you do that. When you actually add an item to array, what it does, it creates new array, copies content from the current array to the new array, adds whatever you wanted to add it, then removes the old array and replaces your new array with all this new stuff with the old one. So this is quite a lot of information going down there, and this is not really designed for that. You can do that, although if you expect you'll be adding more things to the array, there is a special type called array list that actually it's much more flexible than that one. So we have a look how to do it in both cases. So let's come back to my week example. And now I just try to add the just a month to it. So just to show actually it's different if it succeeds, but we say it failed because collection was a fixed size. In other words, you can't really change it. However, PowerShell allows us to add stuff to array with plus equals with that kind of shortcut. And when it happens, we can see there is January at the end. So it done it, but actually that we've done all this heavy lifting I told you behind the scenes. So what we can do instead, if we have, for example, we can also do, we have a couple of arrays. One starts at 1 and finishes at 10, and the other starts at 11 and finishes at 20. I can actually tell PowerShell go and glue them together, which is fine and legal. So we see it starts at 1, ends at 20. But okay. If we want to actually use an array list, we need to dive back a little bit to net framework, and we need to do something of that context, which pretty much says system collections array list. And that form says it pretty much creates new object of array list. So when I do that, and now I say go and add January, it will just do that. Because sometimes net framework methods can actually print out to console, we can suppress this by saying void at the front, which pretty much says print out to nowhere. It's like printing out null, nowhere. So now if we try to add another one, it does nothing. It's like we see if added it, but it didn't print out to the console. And let's try now go to my list, and we can see now we have these two items added. So that's how you can actually add very, very nicely and easily. And this will also not incur the performance hit like you will do with actually adding things to the normal array. And how we can remove from the array lists? We go my name of remove and actually which item we want from that list. So my list, and then remove that object from the array list. So in that case, we should be left only with January, and we are. And this is it. Yep, this is the end of my quick array presentation. Hopefully you've learned something new today. So the quick crash course on the PowerShell arrays, hopefully you'll be able to use them now with more confidence. Because we use, especially when you get to the scripting part, we use a lot of arrays and other sort of collections, so be able to actually manipulate them, iterate through them is quite an important skill. So let me know, you know, whether you liked it or not. And the next step, because actually I wanted to make the video about the hash tables, but really we can't go to hash tables before we get into the array. So the next one video following up this one will be about hash tables. So I'll see you there. Have a great day. Bye bye.